Ever wondered how data leaders are transforming their strategies and how data can be your organization's key differentiator? If you want to know why data products are changing the game before it's too late, then you're in the right place. Here, you can discover the secrets to real-time data transformation and get ready to revolutionize your data strategy. Today, meet Madhukar Kumar, a pioneer where real-time data solutions come to life. He shares insights you need to supercharge your data strategy and exceed your competition. And coming up in this exciting new interview, the importance of being close to product, why the adoption of a product mindset is so important to data teams, and what the rise of data products means to us in data teams and data leadership. You'll also learn a lot about SingleStore and real-time capabilities, which are really fascinating. Now, our guest today, Madhukar, has led a fascinating career, and I'm excited to discuss the insights he has to offer throughout his career. But first, there is one thing I need to know. What are your thoughts, Madhukar, on data leaders adopting a more product-led mindset? Have you seen this in your field and with your customers' data teams?
Absolutely. Without naming names, we've been working with a very large company in the UK as well, and they deal with massive amounts of data. Mm. And this is the way they've started to think about it. And interestingly, this is some of the conversations I'm having with analysts as well. Sure. It is talking about something specifically called data product. Mm-hmm. So imagine you have different kinds of data sources, mm-hmm. different types of data, fast moving, slow moving, static data and whatnot. And there are consumers of that data, both internal to the organization and external. And what you typically do, you sit either create dashboards and give mm-hmm. access to that, or you build specific applications on top of that data, and then you give access to that. And both of them are not really long-term sustainable or scalable because your underlying data keeps changing. So I think that goes back to the overall architecture that you were talking about, which is either a data mesh or a data fabric. And what that effectively means is if I can put some sort of a thin veneer across my entire company's data, and without moving that data, I'm able to give access to certain domains of data to specific users and still maintain the governance, that basically is a data product. So then at that point, I'm saying, okay, Ross, tell me what are your data requirements, and then I assemble it in a materialized view or a virtual table, whatever you want to call it, and then give access to you as a product so that you're using it on a day-to-day basis. And if the underlying data changes, you don't have to do anything. I don't have to do anything. But now if I am the product manager, I'm thinking about the quality of that data and the data domain versus trying to constantly figure out what pipeline is broken, and whether the data coming in made it last night or not, and whether you were able to run your analytics bad job or your pipeline and so on. So I think that's where, when it comes to data, we hear quite a lot that the organizations are moving towards data products and data stories as well. And those data products require a product mindset versus, you know, mostly infrastructure and plumbing mindset.
Wow. I think that's the best I've ever heard it described and explained. That was great. Now, let's take a step back and touch on your career, where it has led you and what your current role is.
I became a product manager. Then I got into product marketing, and I've moved from a number of different tech large orgs to startups. I worked for companies like Zora, which was pre-IPO, companies like Oracle, where I ran the product strategy for their customer experience portfolio of tools, to Redis, which is still pre-IPO, but it's one of the in-memory databases, to Nutanix, and then finally here at SingleStore, which was formerly known as MemSQL. But now I'm firmly in the marketing side of things, which is where my current role is Chief Marketing Officer. And here it's a combination of both code as well as creativity. So that's what I kind of love doing, is bringing technology and creativity together.
I'm interested to know more about what people in data and data leaders can learn about SingleStore. It seems really fascinating.
Think about, and you would get this, Ross, sure. because when we started off, it was databases was basically an advancement from Excel sheets.
Yeah.
it was rows and columns.
Yeah.
And when you had very vast amounts of data that started getting generated with e-commerce application and such, now writing data was a big, big portion of the databases,
sure.
where you could have millions of records that you're writing. And there's, of course, asset compliance, so you're not, you know, locking it for others while you're writing the data. So that transactional database really came into being, and then it evolved into something called in-memory because you wanted to do it fast. And there were three in-memory databases or data stores, whatever you want to call it, about 10, 12 years. There was Memcached, there was Redis. Redis was open source. And then there was MemSQL. And MemSQL is what turned into SingleStore.
Sure.
But why did it turn into SingleStore? And the reason was we started off as an in-memory transactional database, just like Redis, extremely fast, except that it was purely SQL. But over a period of time, internally, we patented a technology that allows that data to go from in-memory to local disk, which is SSDs and NVMEs, and then eventually when the cloud came about, into object storage.
Okay.
And in that process, it also converts that data into columnar data. So it starts in memory, which is optimized in memory row-based, which is optimized for transactional. And then over a period of time, and you can choose this as creation too, it turns into analytical-based use case as well. Now, throughout the history of databases, we have had these two worlds where transaction is really good for a transactional database, but then you extract the data, you transform, you do load, and then you take it to data warehouse or a data lake or, you know, some sort of an analytics database where you're running analytics, but it's a point-in-time analytics. More recently, we started to see Uber-like use cases where data is coming at an incredibly fast speed and it's being generated because people are doing rides and they're booking food delivery and whatnot. And you want to take that data and use it to make a better offer to those customers. So that requires analytics as well, but in a few milliseconds over millions and millions of transactions. So that kind of became the sweet spot of SingleStore. So if I were to now tell you what SingleStore is as of today, it's a combination of SQL, which is in-memory transactional, and columnar, which is, you know, analytics-based. And luckily for us, in 2017, we started adding a lot of additional data types. So we have support for MySQL wired protocol compatibility. We added support for Mongo's JSON libraries. And we have geospatial, we have key value. And because of this sweet spot of doing transactional analytics, some customer came to us and said, hey, we want to also do semantic search. And so in 2017, we also added vectors. And if you're following the whole Gen AI thing, retrieval augmented generation has become really big because now people want to do semantic search in order to talk to the LLMs. And we have had this for several years now. So all of this has now come together where you can do SQL, NoSQL, you can do tabular as well as columnar. You could do it across multiple data types. You can do lexical and semantic, and you can do it in a few milliseconds. That's how I would define what a single store is.
Thanks for explaining. So data leaders looking at single store would be in an organization, and what kind of data roles would there be?
Yeah, I think there are two, I would say. One is, of course, the developers. They're building any applications, any full stack application, or they're looking to build an in-app analytics application or a generative AI application. And then the buyers typically tend to be either in the IT or inside of data science teams, or could be head of IT too, because you're looking to build an architecture that is ready for this new modern way of building applications. And so my usual take on that is, when they're looking at it, the question really to ask is, first of all, I haven't seen any company, or at least I have never worked in a company, no matter how small it is, where they have only one database.
Correct.
They have at least three to begin with. So now with Gen AI, do you really want to add another database that would only do one thing versus taking a look at your data and then really thinking about how you can mix and match different kinds of data, how you can do both lexical as well as semantic search, And you can do it in a private, asset compliant, enterprise way.
What are your thoughts on the direction data is being used and the pain points being encountered in this space? Like, what stands out as an important distinguisher for using data effectively?
Yeah, I think the thing that resonates the most with data leaders about what we do and what SingleStore does is, one, it's real time. So we are talking about a few milliseconds. And I'll explain why that is important,
sure,
specifically for some of the use cases that our customers use for. Two is the fact that you can mix and match different kinds of data. And three is the fact that we have been around for 10, 12 years. So it takes a lot to build a database, specifically when it comes to disaster recovery and, you know, the SLA needs for both transactional analytics and so on. But the real-timeness of it is, I think, what has changed now and is changing even more in the future. Because even with AI application, it's turning multimodal and it's going to be in real time. Like, you imagine you're talking to a robot or a large language model, which is embedded into your glasses. And in that, you ask for a question and it's to translate whatever somebody is telling you in a different language. And it waits for 10 seconds. That's not AI. That's just a gimmick at that point.
Yeah.
So the real-timeness matters because we live in the now. We live in the real-time nature of everything. And data comes at you in a few milliseconds. And even for analytics in real time is what really matters now with most of the application. It used to be, oh yeah, this is a transactional application. The analytics is a different portion. It's for internal users and go to data warehouse and data scientists will go and give you the results. Versus, no, I want to know what's going on right now because I want to use that data to do something with it right now. I always say data is like, a lot of people say it's like water or it's like oil. I say it's more like milk because the value of data falls as the time ages. If I have some valuable data that I cannot action upon right away, a year from now, that data is useless to me. So I think that's where I feel we see a lot more traction as well as resonance.
Wow. Thanks so much for those amazing and super interesting insights. What are your thoughts on the importance of data getting closer to product? And how does this impact the marketing and the audience for product-led organizations and data organizations?
And I feel like if you are in the technology space, you cannot afford to be not close to the product because we are in a product-led world.
Correct.
And I don't mean it in a gimmicky way from a marketing perspective. You build a really great product, and you really, marketing comes down to two things. Taking that product to the right audiences and having the right audiences find your product. Mm-hmm. And then after that, it's purely product design, product experience, product usage, product adoption, sure, and so on. So from that perspective, I would say the CMO title is maybe a little bit of a misnomer. It's more of a product user and a product quote-unquote influencer or whatever you want to call it. And I constantly look for other people like that who are product users and would definitely gain from it. So we've been working with a lot of other folks who are actually using the product and then they are very vocal about how this is different from the other and what would they gain out of this. And those are all organic. Those are things that you don't pay for. Those are not demand generation, but more, I would say, groundswell because your product is good and you have found the right audiences.
As we wrap up today, could you share any SingleStore applications available for data leaders to use and work with so we could understand it in a little bit more detail?
The easiest way I would say anybody can do, and I, you know, even tell students and colleges to go try out, is go to singlestore.com/spaces, SPACES. Just like a Hugging Face Spaces, we have SingleStore Spaces.
Cool.
And there are tons of notebooks with free code that you can use, all the way from large language applications or LLM-based applications, to semantic search and real-time analytics application, mm-hmm. go give it a try. Like, I mean this very genuinely. It's very easy. Just get started in two or three steps, and you would see the difference. We will walk you through the application, what it can do for any data leader.
You can follow Madhukar Kumar on LinkedIn for some more thought-provoking discussions on data leadership. He's awesome. Now, don't miss our next episode where we spoke to fellow data legend, Bhavik Patel, on how product and data can work closer together. And you can unravel the importance and its impact on the enterprise. Stay tuned so you don't miss out on the next big step on your career as a data leader. And I'd really like to thank Amplitude, the best product analytics software, for partnering with us to produce this video. Until next time, bye for now.